that money to good use. The British created this Dravidian movement. The British fostered it, financed it. Without, and through the English education, made sure that you never knew what the origin of the word Dravidian is. Dravidian word is not a Tamil word. Dravidian word is a Sanskrit word, which was invented by, or first publicized by Adi Shankara, when he went to Varanasi to debate Mandara Mishra. You know the Hindu tradition, which is also the Buddhist tradition, Uttaramimsa school tradition, that you could convert somebody individually to your religion if you had a discussion and defeated them in that discussion. That's called Shastrat. And so Shankara went all over the country holding these debates, winning at every place. But the greatest spokesman of Uttaramimsa school was Mandara Mishra in Varanasi. And he challenged him. Now, challenged to a debate, he accepted it, but the question was, who is going to be the umpire? So finally, because one is the greatest spokesman of Hinduism at that time, and the other was the greatest spokesman of Buddhist way of thinking or Uttaramimsa school. And so who will be the umpire? So finally, it was decided that Mandana Mishra's wife will be the umpire. That was his first mistake. Because the wife knows too much about the husband, so she's not going to ever declare him a winner. In fact, Mandana Mishra lost the debate. First question, his wife asked Shankara, "Who are you?" He said, "I'm Dravida Shishu." Shishu means child. What is Dravida? Explain, it's a sandhi of two words, thra and vit. Essentially translated means where the three coasts meet or the three oceans meet. So it was a regional term. But the British made it into a racial term. And this racial term led to even the divisions in interpretation of Ramayana. That Ravan was Dravida and Ram was Arya. The word Aryan doesn't exist in Sanskrit literature. Arya exists, means a cultured noble person. And in Tamil we say Aya. Every word we have some similar word. But Ravan was not even a Dravidian in that sense. He was not even a regionally a South Indian. Because he was born in Noida, which is just on the border of Delhi. His wife Mandutri was born in Meerut. He came to know about Guber and Sri Lanka. So he went and conquered Sri Lanka. And after that he was constantly trying to conquer Ayodhya. So therefore there was no such concept. How, on what basis the British created this? All on artificial basis. Color, skin color has got nothing to do with race. It has got to do with pigmentation. Michael Jackson proved it by taking out his pigmentation, he began looking like a white man. Race is decided by DNA. Can you produce a single study in this country or in the world which says that the Indian DNA between North and South is different? It's the same. Recently, the University of Cambridge has come out with a study. The University of Texas in Houston, the University of Houston University. They've all come out with studies that the DNA of Indian is the same. But for years and years, and even now, this Aryan-Dravidian theory is being used. That a group of people, the whole of India was being ruled by Dravidians. Then the Aryans came from Khyber Pass. They were brutal people. They drove the Dravidians to the south and created this. This has to be demolished, it's being slowly demolished. I found in one debate I had, not one debate, newspaper exchange, in the Hindu newspaper for some reason unknown to anybody, including myself, Ram and I are very good friends. So if I give anything to publish, he publishes it. So Romila Thapar wrote an article about India's secularism. And there she says that she's not an adherent to the Aryan Dravidian theory. Took me by surprise, because for years she has been propagating this Aryan Dravidian theory, even to the extent of saying that Ashoka was a Greek. That when Alexander came to India and conquered India, he fathered the grandfather of Ashoka. Now, of course, now she can't say that, but she's given it up. Slowly that thing is cracking. But we need a death blow. So I think the next article should be, the next book of yours should be the Aryan Dravidian theory. But it needs to be demolished completely. In fact, some little work I had done myself. I persuaded Karunanidhi to stop celebrating Ravan as Ravan Leela. Because I explained to him that both in Valmiki Ramayana and in Kamban Ramayana, Ravan was a Brahmin. I have seen this myself in terms of in actual experience when I got the Chinese, persuaded Chinese to reopen Kailash Mansarovar. I went as the first traveler to Kailash. On the way to Mansarovar, I saw there was a huge lake, which I had never heard about. So I asked the guide, what lake is this? He says it is called Ravan Haranga, sometimes called Rakshastal. So I said, why is it called Ravan? What is Haranga? Haranga's sarovar, lake. Why Ravan? He said, so somebody from India came here and he meditated here. So I said, in that case, let me go and have a bath first there, and then I will go to Mansarovar. She said, no, if you have a bath there, you will get itches all over your body. If you drink the water, you will die. So of course, I filled a bottle of water and came back and gave it to Karunanidhi and said, please drink it and show me. Now the Dravida movement used to name their sons as Ravanan. Not anymore. But now, I mean, you can find many middle-aged and old-aged people who got the name Ravanan. So this is the extent it went to. And sometimes it became pathetic. The leader of the Dravidian movement, E.V. Ramaswamy Nayakar, E.V. Ramaswamy Nayakar, he wrote a letter in 1944, which I got a copy of, in which he is pleading with Jinnah to include in the creation of Pakistan an independent Dravidistan. And Jinnah, as a convinced Aryan, says, Dravida, you have nothing in common with us. You must fight for yourself. It's a pathetic letter. The same E.V. Ramaswamy Nayakar went on 15th August 1947 to the governor of Madras and said, let the British go from anywhere in India, but in Tamil Nadu, please do not leave. We need you. We want to work under you. We want to serve you. Of course, the British by then had given up hope, and they didn't listen. So I am saying today that we must adopt an idea and a concept of an identity of an Indian. If you read the literature of Al-Qaeda, or for matter the secret researches going on in Saudi Arabia, and I came to know this because I had a Saudi Arabian student in my class at Harvard, who one day came to ask me that I've been asked to ask you a question, which is not connected with the course. So I said, you ask me after the class is over. So he asked me that we are studying this question, that when Islam went to Iran, and it was being ruled by Zoroastrians, it It was 100% Zoroastrian country. Within 15 years of the conquest of Iran, Iran was converted to 100% Islam. Neighborhood, which called Babylon and Mesopotamia, they, after takeover by Islam, they converted them in 17 years to Islam, 100% Islam. The same thing with Egypt, 21 years, 100% Islam. The Christians went to Europe, and they converted Europe to 100% Christian in 50 years. But in India, 800 years of Islamic rule, 200 years of Christian rule, and you're still 83%. He said, you can't understand. And the reason is that Indians kept, or Hindus, kept fighting. And it's not that the Muslims didn't join. In fact, Shivaji had a Muslim general there. Oh, and there were Hindus in Aurangzeb's army also. But those are exceptions. But the Hindus fought. And the most glorious empire we produced for 350 years was born in Karnataka. The Vijayanagaram Empire, founded in Hampi, Hastinapur. By the way, Mandara Mishra, after he converted to Hinduism, Adi Shankara appointed him as the first Shankaracharya of Sringeri. So Sringeri Ashram began with that. And one of the successor Sringeri Acharyas, they created Vijayanagaram Empire on the basis of two young Muslim boys who were reconverted to Hinduism. Hukka and Bukka or something like that. It lasted 350 years. It spread right up to Assam. It covered more territory than Mughal rule ever. And Mughal rule, really the core Mughal rule was from Akbar to Aurangzeb. It's 150 years only. But you see the history books, one chapter for each Mughal emperor. But Vijayanagaram Empire, one paragraph. In South India, there was an empire called Vijayanagaram Empire. North Indians, even today, do not know Vijayanagaram Empire. So we need a new history book to tell you your identity. And they were fighting, fighting, fighting. What about Guru Gobind Singh? What about the sacrifice of Guru Tegh Bahadur? So these are the things that have to be brought into a book. I mean, I'm very happy about the book he's written about Breaking India, because I'm a Tamilian. And as a Tamilian, I've been fighting this Dravidian movement from day one. Most other anti-Dravidian people are too afraid to fight them because they are a bit violent. But then I know how to take care of violent people also. I have taken care of the LTT in no time, as when I was minister and knocked them out of India. And later on marshaled international forces to see that that fellow doesn't survive, despite the best efforts of the government of India to save them. Nevertheless, I'm saying today to you, first of all, this is first point. Second point is this Hindu lack of self-esteem. He becomes very, very diffident. Moment you say Hindu, oh no, see, I am not communal, please don't involve me in all this.